Well, the songs, for the most part, are assembled in the order they were recorded, but more so in the way it ends, because the first, like the starting point of the record, I believe the first song that I recorded was just A Car Crash Away, but I didn't see any other song starting the record after I recorded If I Was Your Vampire, and that's the way I want to start my live show. But Eat Me, Drink Me was absolutely the last song that I recorded, and I thought it was the way that I wanted to close the record. And I never wrote a record in that sense. I never wrote a record with that intent. So it was, you know, I think people can listen to it however they want, but emotionally, when you introduce something, it has a cause and effect, and you know, something that follows a song like If I Was Your Vampire is gonna be different than if it preceded it. So that was definitely an intentional structure. If I Was Your Vampire is very, you know, it sounds very specific because it starts with 6 a.m. Christmas morning. And that's like right in the middle of my whole transformation, I guess, or resurrection or whatever it might be. Because at that point, when I wrote that song, I didn't even know for sure that this record would happen. But I wrote that song, and I think singing that and finishing that song, especially with the end refrain of this is where it starts, this is where it will end, it gave birth to the whole record. Even if there was stuff before or after it, this song was very key. And it was inspired greatly by me being completely tormented over the holidays, which is a misnomer if you don't celebrate them. And in the midst of my really great depression, Jesus said, you can stab me if that makes you feel better. You know, she meant it, and it wasn't some sort of blind moment, except that romance is, you know, blind moment. And at that point, I didn't have any reason to suffer. When you have someone that's willing to make that kind of a gesture, and I immediately, at that moment, knew I had to write a song about it. And I wrote that song, and that song was completely written about and for that moment. And that, I think at that point, the record came alive. I think I made that comparison. Well, I knew that you're taking on the subject of vampire in music, especially in goth music. You know, you really have to live up to legacy, and Bela Lugosi's Dead is particularly, to me, maybe the, what, not maybe, just it's ultimately the anthem when it comes to that, and especially being associated with the film The Hunger. So I felt obligated to try and not outdo it, but try and bring it up to date with whatever I could do. And I think I accomplished that. I think that this song is definitely full of the same romance and drama and violence and sexual violence to it. It was very violent, I think, song, but I now associate that with passion. Well, I didn't really concentrate specifically on instrumentation, on what would dominate, except that I knew that making this record, I really wanted to have an album that complemented the vocals. Like in the same way Daniel Ash and Peter Murphy, Bowie, and Mick Ronson, I wanted to make something that was like Jagger, Richards, something that really delivered. And it was actually very inspiring that there was a lot of amazing guitar that made me have to rise to the occasion as a singer. And I didn't want it to be something that was just void, empty gesturing. You know, I think that the guitar work is very emotional and it reflects the lyrics because we did them together at the same time. And I think that it really kind of takes it to a level that I wasn't able to before musically. Well, I've been in a fortunate circumstance where the record company was arguing over what should be the first single, so I think we'll get to see more than one single out of this record. But that song, to me, was really... It really did something for me. I wrote this on my birthday, and it mentions the word birthday, it mentions Valentine's Day, it mentions a lot of things in it. And it's one of those songs where I never thought that this song would happen. I had heard the guitar riff and I contemplated it. I didn't really know how to, what I would do to really take it to a song. And it took me waking up on my birthday and getting kissed by a wonderful girl and saying, oh, you taste like Valentine's Day, and thinking, oh, I'm gonna write a song about this, just like everything else that I'm exploiting your muse for. And we deliberately thought, like, if we're going to have a guitar solo on this record, let's be very arrogant about it. Let's make a point of it. And that's why I wanted to put it second on the record. And I thought this is a great guitar solo. It's amazing. And just when you think it's going to end, it just goes that extra step to the next level. And I didn't think there was any part of it that I would take out. I thought it was perfect. So this is the way I reintroduce myself musically, especially by the second song. Putting Holes in Happiness at one point. And I almost contemplated calling the record that, but I thought that it would be really misleading. But the night before that I wrote this song and I sang this song, because I sang it the same day that I wrote it, the take that's on the record is the first time that I sang it. I sang it while discovering the melody, which I'm very, very proud of, and that's why I like the song. And the night before, I watched Bonnie and Clyde, and the song can easily be perceived as a negative comment on relationships. But if you flip it and you think about that film, especially the opening of that film, there, you know, it's a, kind of represents where the moment before Bonnie and Clyde die, that they took this photograph, and sort of in the joy of their chaos. And that's what really inspired me. So it could sound as easy as it's about some bitter memory of a relationship gone bad, but it's really a bit of guilt for a relationship gone good. And to me that's my all-time song that I would love to, you know, put next to All the Young Dudes and Ziggy Stardust and songs like that. I'm sure she is. I'm sure it's kind of overwhelming to be involved with a train wreck. Train wreck is such myself, but it's like, I think ultimately it's more important that I focus on the ultimate good outcomes of the past year. That I never wanted this record to be some sort of commentary on bad things that happened. And I got in this discussion in the midst of having a divorce where I had to make it very clear this record isn't about anybody else, it's about me. It's about how I feel, because I'm not really lashing out or reflecting or even contemplating the outside world. I'm just talking about how I feel. I'm taking all the responsibility on myself. And I think if anybody's happy about the record, yes, they should be happy that I met her, but it's not her responsibility to take the blame for whether it's good or not. The Red Carpet Grave is the probably the only song on the record that has almost any sort of hostile element to it, because the record is really not angry. It's tragic in a lot of ways, but that song people hear and they associate it with sort of like a breakup or some sort of bitterness to it, but it's really a commentary. Like, that was written in the center of my whole experience, in the center of the record, really. And to me, it was, I wanted to be very mythic in it. I wanted to, I mean, the biggest inspiration for that song was Benny and the Jets by Elton John. I wanted to have a song that was not about so much one particular woman, that it was about how relationships go. So the verse is very specific, and then the chorus is very declarative. You know, I'm saying something that's like a fortune cookie or something. So that song I like a lot, but it stands out a little bit different than a lot of the other songs. It's kind of how I've felt in a lot of relationships, not just my marriage, that a lot I've kind of I suppose put myself in a emotional mental position where a lot of people have held me hostage and said, I'm gonna leave you if you don't do this, or I'm gonna, you know, that sort of idea, you know, they said, I'm gonna leave you or else. And I've said or else. And the results have been really life-changing, because I suddenly realized that I don't have to be held hostage in that way. And it made me understand relationships different in all walks of life. They said The Hell's Not Hot was another song that I think people wanted to have as a single. I didn't really mind either way what would be the first single, but that song in particular I didn't think would be first to lead out, because I didn't think it represented the record on its own. Because to me, it's the most sad song. Like, I have a hard time listening to that without getting a little teared up over it. That song to me is the most depressing song. And that song, I don't really know. I haven't had the time, the distance to really like think about that one, but that song, I think a lot of people that hear it identify with it on a way that maybe I didn't understand, because it's very human. Just a Car Crash Away is the first song that I sang. It's one vocal, it's one take, it's pretty much the first try, and I left it as is. And if I wanted to try and showcase or show off myself as a singer, this would be the song that I would really hold up, because I feel very proud of it and it's very emotional. And this song I can't listen to at all, because I cry when I listen to it. But it's like, it's a really sad song. And it's sad because it's commenting on one thing that's dying and one thing that's also being born. And it's really, it's tough. It's a really hard song. And I feel eternally cursed that I don't even want to get in a car because of the song, because I feel like it's really tempting fate that, you know, something, I don't really know what brought it on, but it's I guess it's sort of maybe like when I was a kid, I heard Leader of the Pack and Hell on these records that were, you know, every great rock album, I guess, maybe has a theme, so maybe it was my time to have that. Yeah, originally, you know, it's just simply it called the song When the Heart Guides the Hand, but it was a placard that I saw on a funeral home sort of engraving. And I thought it said so many different things. But obviously, the simpler, I refer to the song as Heart-Shaped Glasses from the beginning. And, you know, the song is very much a reflection on the time that I remember in the past, but also reminded by the present and inspired greatly by Lolita, especially the Kubrick cover of Lolita. And, you know, 100% this song was written the day that my girlfriend showed up wearing heart-shaped glasses. And she did it sarcastically because of some people's perception of our relationship. And we, the fact that she's sardonic enough to have done that amused me. And I said, I immediately have to write a song about this. And the song went from being just novel to being very serious and being very dark. I think it's one of the darkest songs on the record. Although immediately I thought it was automatically, I almost felt embarrassed that it was such a pop song initially, until, you know, automatically it became one of my favorites on the record. I worked with James Cameron's 3D stereoscopic technology on the video, and unfortunately that's only viewable in the theater, but you know, for me, it's artistically, I had to really concern myself with the two-dimensional version of what existed, so I only looked at the 3D, you know, initially, because I knew what it could accomplish, but I had to make sure just cinematically that it would work on television, on DVD. Because this is, it's a type of 3D that we haven't seen yet. And when you see it, it's amazing. But until you see it, it doesn't really make you interested. You know, it's, we've all seen 3D, so it's not nothing. But when you see it, it's really impressive. So I wanted to make something that was really groundbreaking, something that was more controversial than what you would normally do in 3D, because it was essentially the one of Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, but not Honey, I Fucked the Kids. And that made it a little bit more offensive. And so they got a little bit, you know, worked up over what I did. But I think at the end of the day, if it is seen in 3D, it's going to be impressive. It's definitely from here to eternity, but in blood. So it's, I think it's a very romantic video. It definitely rebels without a cause, and tragic and dramatic in that way. And not so much offensive or pornographic or violent in an obvious way, but in a way that you can't really censor, because it's the overall content that's just too much. So that's the way I like to do things. Evan was my one and only choice, and you know, everyone's really worked up over whether or not, you know, how much she was paid for the video, but she's definitely paid more than any actress has ever been paid for a music video, but is worth every dime. But I, you know, because she's, to me, such a talented actress, I wanted her to be respected in that way, and I wanted her to be represented in that way as a director, you know, aside from as her being my, you know, romantic interest in life. So I made it, you know, I essentially wrote something for her, and I wouldn't have settled for anyone else. So whatever millions of dollars that had to be paid for her, I can't confirm or deny. It was all worth it. Thank you. I think evidence is, actually I use evidence in the long form version of the video, which is, I hesitate to call it a short film because it's more of a long form video, but I use the instrumental version of evidence as the score for the sex scene that opens up because it, to me it's the most guttural, visceral track on the record, and maybe it's because of this kind of tribal drums and bass, and it's really the raw and basic. I like that song a lot. I think fuck is the only curse word that I use on the record, and I use it twice, and it's very different. And on evidence, it's, I mean, it's the only word you could use in that circumstance. And on the other song, mutilation is the most sincere form of flattery. It's not angry at all. You know, I'm always, I suppose, notorious for, you know, being aggressively profane. And this is very, I guess, disgusted, very, it's just a different approach. I don't really know the word for it, except that that song fits it. So this isn't a record that you could really put a parental advisory on for its exact profanity. It's more for the content. And I'm proud of that. I Eat the Rabbit was a track that, you know, very much originated with the finger snapping. And I thought immediately this song is gonna be played in every strip bar across the universe, which is a good thing. But it then led me to write lyrics that were probably my most childishly dirty and intentionally. But it, of course, the rabbit reference makes people automatically associate it with Lewis Carroll. And for me, it was a reference more to sort of innocence and me being, you know, more of a wolf and a rabbit and that type of thing. But no, I like this song a lot. It's to me, it's where the record starts to get some sort of moment of not cheerfulness, but it lightens up for a moment towards the end. This song is comprised of a lot of sloganeering that I wrote in regards to my outlook on art, you know, especially with my celebritarian concept of art movement, which unfortunately didn't get a chance to really gain any momentum because of what collapsed in my personal life. But that doesn't mean it's not going to now. But this song I think initially seemed only as a comment on things outside of me, you know, other bands or stuff like that, is what people perceived as. But also, to me, when I wrote it, I perceived it very greatly about relationships. And I wanted it, a lot of the songs on the record, I really went to a great effort in my head to make them very much double meaning or triple meaning for a lot of things. So this song, you know, also reflects the fact that I've, you know, spent a great portion of my life, you know, being self-destructive and self-mutilating, and I just thought that the title did seem like it needed to happen on the record. One day. I think it's in general, you know, that's like one of the moments where people often perceive it as a comment on other bands that try to be like me, but I also meant it as relationships that try to manipulate me. But that song is at the end because it's the second to last song that I did. I did that song, I did Eat Me, Drink Me, the last two songs that I recorded. And for whatever reason, I had a really terrible skunk problem in my household. And it turned out to be 8 skunks total captured living underneath my house. So hygiene wasn't ever a problem for me because it smelled like skunks in my house for 1 year. And in this song, we recorded me beating on a skunk cage that the skunk trapper, because apparently it's illegal or improper to kill skunks. He said I'm free into someone else's lawn. So this song was completely I think it's at the point in the record where it gets a little bit most histrionic, or like retreading ground that I've already done. I wanted to make a song that was, strangely in some way, this song was inspired by John Lennon, which probably is a real stretch, but it was inspired by Obla-Dee Obla-Da, which is completely different than that. But, so I wanted to make a song that was just really based off of a few scraps of lyrics that I wrote on hotel memo pads. And the first one being, you know, if we get in bed, someone will fall in love, you and me in the double mix 3. And that was kind of the essence of where it originated. It was, Eat Me, Drink Me was the last song I recorded for the record, and it wasn't really until that point that I had decided on the title of the album. Because I had really, for the first time, been at a loss for what I wanted to call it and what I wanted to focus around, which is usually the first thing that I do. But when I did this song, it really all made sense. And this song is, to me, probably the most, I guess, if you were to use the term album track, like this song, I put a lot of, I don't really know what the, I don't really know how to describe it, except that the song has, an additional verse that's not even listed lyrically, that's chopped up amongst some of the strange musical breaks. And the song was written really as an ending to the record, and I've never really written things in that order, but I wrote it as this needs to be the last song of the record, and I wrote it in that way. And I think, you know, it was greatly inspired by Invitation to a Beheading by Nabokov, And also, it was inspired by me reflecting upon the other 10 songs and thinking, how do I end this record?